Good evening, everyone. We have a quorum. We'll get started. It's just after 5:30. Welcome to the Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee, Tuesday 6th of December. This is the last one for the year, I believe. Potentially, yes. I'd like to thank myself. I'd like to thank the chair. Okay, members, the Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee, the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee, the Economic and Community Development Committee, and the Finance and Business Services Committee, because we're running all four committees this evening, the public meetings will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of these meetings. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed and published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. That is quite correct. The Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee acknowledges that we're meeting in the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with their land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. I don't have any apologies in any absence. Who's missing? Councillor Abraham's on his way. Councillor Correll saw her 5 minutes ago, so she's here. May I have confirmation of minutes from the 8th of November? Councillor Wilkinson, seconded Lord Mayor. I'll put that. All those in favour, declare that carried. Excellent. Public forums, we have none. We have a report, we have none, except to say Merry Christmas to everyone. And I'll just now call for items for adoption on block. Members, I will call out item number 7, proposed community garden for Murniwara. But Councillor Bashaw. Item number 8, draft North Parklands concept plan. Item number 9, seeking to vary encroachment policy to allow balcony, blah blah blah. Councillor Wilkinson. Item number 10, seeking variation to encroachment policy for 131 Peary. Councillor Martin. And that's it. Can I have a mover, please, for item number 8? Councillor Wilkinson, seconded by Lord Mayor. I'll put that. All those in favour, declare that carried. Thanks very much. I now go back to item number 7, Councillor Bashaw. Before I hand over to you, Councillor Bashaw, I'll just advise everyone that we do have members of the Central Queensland Universities in the gallery, so welcome. And they are here if we want to ask them any questions. So I'll be guided by you all members if you do want to do that. I'll hand over to you.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to move a small amendment through the
moving with, as printed with an amendment change. Yep.
Which is a 1.6, which is no car tyres, car stroke buses to be used on site.
Windscreens.
Oh, right, just hang on. Okay, so we'll just put that into some nice English language. Is it approved subject to?
No car tyres, comma, car stroke buses and shipping containers
and windscreen
to be used, or windscreen wipers to be used on site.
Okay, do I have a seconder for as printed and with that amendment? Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. I think this is a great proposal and I look forward to the feedback from the consultation. The group from the University of Queensland have presented to APLA and to Council. I think it's a great use of that area of the parklands and I hope the consultation comes back to with positive.
Thank you, Councillor Clavell.
There's no room, obviously.
Yeah, I agree with comments. And actually, this came up at APLA, and it was discussed extensively that everybody in the room supported this proposal, but wanted to see the absence of and removal of any references to car tyres and buses and old car wrecks and things like that. And also the potential shipping container. Yeah.
Thank you. Do I have any other speakers? Would that be summing up? Summed up? I'll put that, members, all those in favour, declare that carried. I have noticed we're running out of chairs in this room of late. We might have to have a look at that.
One too many, Councillor.
Sorry. We'll okay. Item number 9, Councillor Wilkins.
Me too.
Just on reviewing this item in the agenda and discussing it with council staff.
Are you moving it as printed?
I'm moving as recommended.
Okay, can I call for a seconder, please? Councillor Abbott.
In contrast to the other one put up by the same proponents, where they were further down the track, and because of banking changes, asked that just on this occasion that they have the entirety of the balconies overhanging the footpath, which did increase the value of their apartments by $7,500 a square metre to the tune of the additional floor area gained. But on this instance, it was early in the process, these balconies are within the 50% in and 50% out encroachment, but exceed the 30% of the length of the building proposal. I'm of the view that basically multi-storey buildings, when we review our policy, that we shouldn't have balconies overhanging the public realm at all, and the tower should be set back and all balconies should be within the bounding proper. But given the current allowances and the current council policy, I think in this instance, exceeding the 30% length is acceptable, given the current policy setting, which I would like to actually mean, so we don't actually have the balcony hanging the footpath at all. So in this circumstance, I'm supportive of this. The question is about the charge for the balconies overhanging the public realm. And the current policy provides that one can overhang a balcony if you have 50% within your property, you know, 50% over the public realm, for no consideration whatsoever. But every square metre that is overhanging the public realm increases the property value of the apartment by $7,500 a square metre. And for us to give that away for free for a residential property like this, I think is not correct. And I perhaps ask the administration at this juncture, given the current policy settings, because under the new policy settings, I would move that we do not give away this sort of financial advantage for nothing, what opportunity we have to charge more commercial rates.
Can I just say, Councillor Wilkinson, if I recall the last month, you've moved a motion that we are reviewing the policy, so I would suggest that would be a part of that review.
Well, I'm asking administration now, what juncture we have.
Through the presiding member, as part of the policy review, the fees associated with commercial and residential developments will also be incorporated into that policy review.
And will that be able to be retrospectively applied?
That will be a decision for council, but right. At this point, I haven't considered it as being part of the review. It will be it's challenging with policy review where expectations are that people are, you know, in line with current policy. So where there's no fees currently being set, I wouldn't be proposing retrospective. It could be future oriented.
Councillor Abiad, would you like to Councillor Hender? Lord Mayor?
Thanks, Chair. I support the recommendation, Chair, but I do have a question through to administration. And most particularly, I note that with regards to the shielding of air conditioning units, which will be sitting on the balconies of said building, What guarantee, Claire, do we have that they will be shielded by appropriate mesh or whatever that may be? Because, of course, without that, they can be unsightly.
Through the chair, there are unfortunately no guarantees, but there are conditions on the development consent issued by DAC. So if indeed they become a problem and aren't in accordance with the development plan conditions, then council could quite effectively take action. So that would be not necessarily under the question of the encroachments, that's as part of the development approvals.
Okay, so should, for example, and not singling out this particular developer, but should any developer whereby they have a DAC approval, which then talks to the shielding of air conditioning units sitting on balconies, not comply with that, council does have some form of recourse?
Yes, it does.
Okay, and you would bring that to our attention should you find at any stage in the future a development did not comply with that provision?
Through the chair, and provided we were aware of that, yes, we would.
Okay, Chair, I think that's something we should be fairly firm on in terms of residential developments in the City of Adelaide, is the appropriate covering and shielding of air conditioning units on balconies. They can be very unsightly, just like that noted.
Thank you. I guess this doesn't relate to the encroachment policy, but I think the administration can take it on notice.
Yeah, it's in the report.
Let me finish my sentence, Councillor Jones. Councillor Bishop?
Just following on from that point, I know in the site plans that none of them are shown on the site plan. None of the air conditioning units are actually shown. So are they part of the development to be on the balconies? Definitely.
Through the chair, I'm not aware that they're meant to be on the balconies. The proposal you have before you is really a site plan to show the encroachment. It's not a site plan to show the nitty-gritty detail of what's proposed. In terms of furniture or fixtures within each floor plate.
But they're not on any site plan.
This is not
part
of
the
order. No, it's right. Not. It'll be sleeping around. Sorry, I've just been given an update on item number 10, so I'll just come back to that. So, Councillor Wilkinson?
Just in summary, I'll just pick up on the topic about the air conditioning. I don't think that council, the policy is currently very lenient and not really intended at this scale of development. It's designed for 2 or 3 storey development, not development the scale to be overhanging footpath. But the matter of air conditioning is, the drawings are silent on that. And I don't think that council ought to be sanctioning or condoning having air conditioning units overhanging the public realm in any event. So I think
we've covered that topic.
Well, I'm just summing up with the chair, if you allow me. So just picking up on the points that people have made that they're obviously concerned about, that you may not be, that the air conditioning is something which is important, that we don't have a third world country situation where you get air conditioners, which are typically 2 metres high these days, on balconies, spoiling the public realm. But, I think this, given the current what's in setting, I think this proposal is acceptable within those parameters.
Members, I'll put that, all those in favour, declare that carried. Members, I've just been given an update that item 10 has been withdrawn from our agenda, and I'll just hand it to CEO.
Thanks, Chair. I'll just ask Director Justin Commons to explain the reason why it's been withdrawn. Thanks, Justin.
It's item 413 of the other committee, so it's not item 10 of this development.
Yeah.
So item 10 on this committee is fine.
Okay, fine. My goodness. Very confused, you're right. Right, then Councillor Martin.
I will move as printed.
Can I have a second, please?
No, after a question, if I may. The question, the answer to the question will...
Do you want someone else to move it, or...
Oh, whatever.
Can I just get a mover and a seconder, if we can, Lord Mayor, seconded by one people? Who's seconding?
I'm happy to second.
Councillor Simon. Lord Mayor, would you like to reserve your right and...
I reserve my right and enable Councillor Martin to speak.
Don't wish to speak, just a quick question, and I apologise for not having had the opportunity to ask it. Is the motion that's being proposed to waive fees or simply to waive the encroachment policy?
Through the Chair, the recommendation is purely to waive the provisions of the encroachment policy, not the fee.
Okay, thank you.
Lord Mayor, did you move?
I will, Chair, thank you. Being a commercial premises, I presume that fees would be payable. Chair, I've got a question through administration. Look, it is wonderful to see the Rhino Room finding a new location, and I think on the corner of Perry and Hyde Street, a very appropriate location, because the Feast building in Raj House is just located directly behind it, so it's going to build a little bit of a hub in that area, so I think we would welcome that. And we know there was some angst expressed by the Rhino Room about where their whereabouts may be, and this looks like a terrific outcome for them, so well done. Chair, my question through administration is one of aesthetics. In terms of these drawings are indicative only, but I'm just hoping, given there are already vines on this building, that this could be, it looks fairly industrial. And Shanti, is there any way in which we could feed into this process to ensure that this is aesthetically in harmony with the street?
Through the Chair, so this is literally the first step in the process of gaining consent for the encroachment. The application is in the process of being assessed, so that subject can clearly be addressed through the development assessment process. Council is the relevant authority in this instance.
Thank you, Shanti. That answers my question. Thank you, Chair.
Councillor Flower, did you... Deputy Lord Mayor, you can take Councillor Wilkinson.
Looking at the visuals, there are some huge signboards on the facade. Are they... I know there's one on display.
Is that related to the encroachment policy, Councillor Wilkinson?
Well, that encroaches public realms. The question is, are they... part of this proposal?
Through the Chair, the proposal you have before you is for waiving the encroachment. The assessment of any signage and the structure itself need to go to a separate assessment process.
What's shown on illustration and why is that proposed signage?
Through the Chair, I can't answer that question. I can check that up and get back to you.
So the answer is no, it's not part of this consideration right now. We're purely looking at the encroachment policy. That's the answer to the question.
My concern is the this building didn't originally have a balcony. It's an unlisted historic building. At least the building not being demolished, that's a good thing. Those signage hoardings and things look horrendous, and they're going to be encroaching the public realm. And so I wouldn't want to see us sanctioning signage like that encroaching the public realm. This is the way it started.
The signage is...
What I would say just about the reason why this particular proposal doesn't comply with the current policy is because their current policy limits the length of a balcony encroachment to 30% of a building facade. And if you think of a building like the Lion Hotel of North Adelaide, where the balcony wraps around this entirely desirable historic balcony, that wouldn't actually meet our current 30% rules, which is why I think we need to revisit not basically giving away $7,500 a square metre to bring forward a multi-storey development, but also why allowing the entirety of the frontage of one or two storey balcony to overhang the public by continuous pedestrian canopy and shelter.
Right, Lord Mayor, would you like to sum up?
Thanks, Chair. Well, this council encourages basement and upper level and balcony activations, Chair. It's good for the streetscape. It's a great outcome for the Rhino Room, so I commend this motion to my fellow elected members.
Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Thank you. Members, there are no items for committee to receive a note. There are no out of session papers. Do I have any other business? Yeah. Councillor Martin?
Yes, I have a couple of questions without notice, Chair. A question to the administration on which the Lord Mayor may wish to provide commentary. Last week at Council, the Lord Mayor undertook to raise in a meeting the following day with the Minister for Planning, John Rowe, the Minister's decision to disregard Council's decision to not support the expansion of St Dominic's School in North Adelaide beyond its current boundaries, and to specifically ask if that expansion meant the Minister had rejected Council's position, including an appeal to conserve about a dozen properties which we deem to be worthy of heritage listing, whether that means that the North Adelaide Colleges and Institutions Plan has been rejected. Did the Lord Mayor receive an answer?
Well, that is for the administration to answer. The question on without notice is for administration, not for committee to answer.
That's fine.
Through the presiding member, I would need to take that on notice and provide a response in due course.
Okay. Well, okay, all right, I'll accept that, but I'm just wondering why we haven't been informed when the meeting happened almost a week ago. An associated question that may also need to be taken on notice. At that same council meeting, or at least the same council meeting last week, the Lord Mayor undertook to raise with the Minister his proposed use of the little known section 49 Part 2C of the Development Act 1993 to push through DAC the St Dominic's Priory College expansion rather than council. Did the Minister indicate if he planned to use this mechanism at other sites around North Adelaide?
Again, I would need to take that on notice and just get some confirmation from the relevant staff that attended the meeting.
Can the administration indicate if Minister Rao or any other minister, for that matter, in 23 years has used Section 49 Part 2C of the Development Act?
Through the presiding member, for public infrastructure, yes, but I do need to take this on notice.
I meant specifically in respect of private enterprise developments here.
Yeah, I think you have to take
out
notice.
Yeah, that's fine. That's just clarity. The second issue, the final question to the administration is, I note that questions without notice do not appear in the minutes. Is that a recent innovation?
Only if we, as a council, vote for them to appear in the minutes. You have to actually move specifically that they do.
Okay, I'd like to move that those questions be added to the minutes.
Will the answer be that they'll be taken on notice, technically? That's the quick question. That be the answer? It'll be the questions that'll go into the minutes.
I'm happy to move that, Chair.
Okay, Councillor Wilkinson is seconding that.
Doesn't it go on the agenda, so to have it in the minutes?
No.
Not unless we vote on it.
What I mean is...
Not if it's moved and seconded and voted.
If it's a question that's been taken on notice, that will come in.
Sorry, this is a question without notice, though.
Yes, but they've been taken.
Councillor Lang, let's just... We want to be here or not, let's just...
What if you encourage?
There's been a mover and a seconder who have requested for this to go on notice in the minutes. Do I have anyone who wants to speak to that? Councillor Rowe, would you like to speak to it?
No.
Well, I'll vote then. All those in favour? All those against? That are carried. Do I have any other business? Oh, Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I have a motion without notice.
Go for it.
Thank you. Having regard to Prospect Council's bid to secure more than $7 million for parklands projects on or near its boundaries, committee asks the administration to provide, as a matter of urgency, formal advice to council on how best to ensure A, an equitable and transparent outcome for all adjoining councils, and B, an alignment with the priorities set out in Adelaide City Council's recently endorsed Parkland Strategic Management Plan.
Now, first of all, we're going to need those words because no one can be possibly expected to just listen to that and see those words. Can you bring them over here? Members, I can only encourage you to email these things out to everyone as a respect and courtesy to everyone so that they can read them prior, so you don't put them on the spot. So can I have those words that will put them up on the screen so that everyone can read them?
Yep. Thank you.
Right, members, can I just get you to read what is on the screen? And I'll call for a seconder. Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Chair. Look, this proposed prospect development has prompted some ratepayers to ask what criteria we as a council use to determine as a priority these prospect projects. As set out in the letter from the Mayor of Prospect to our Lord Mayor dated November 24th. And I am being asked why this is called the North Parklands Project when it centres around only the City of Prospect boundaries insofar as Parks 2 and 3 are concerned, when our document says that the Parklands, North Parklands precinct around North Adelaide is Parks 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. And I'm also being asked how it was determined that about half the priorities identified in our key moves in the strategic plan had not been included, like the promised community oval, toilets and barbecue facilities in Park 4. There's no fenced walking trail around Park 6 near the horse pastures, and the Glover playground integration is missed out too. So what were the equitable and transparent criteria used for that outcome? And also, I want to know, what was the criteria for the new proposals in the prospect letter and motion that are not in our strategic plan, like the entrance to the City of Prospect, identified at F on the map supplied, which appears to be in Prospect and not on the parklands? And I can't find anywhere in our strategy, and I'm happy to be guided to it, a half a million dollar sensory Australian native trail. That's a new one to me. Now, I'm not saying that these are bad projects, that I have a problem with them. I'm just asking, what is the criteria for creating this list, and how do we ensure this plan and any others we receive align with our priorities, that is Adelaide City Council's priorities in the parkland, because it could be confusing. And then as a council, I'd like to know, and I hope everyone else does, what are our highest priorities? For example, the prospect list appears to be the first and only proposal that council has endorsed for submission to the state government for funding. But our parkland strategic plan says that our highest priorities include projects such as reimagining Rymal Park post-Oban by improving access and amenity and realigning the kiosk. Our plan also attached the highest priority to reimagining Beale Gardens for our ratepayers in the south. And for residents in the central ward, our strategy's highest priority was establishing a formal garden near the Royal Adelaide Hospital. Then there was the plan to relocate the skate park. That was a high priority too. The one that was dispossessed by the state government resuming land for the medical precinct. So with about $5 million of the $20 million that was originally allocated by the government for the parklands, with $5 million set aside for Marshmallow Park, I reckon there's about 15 left, and this proposal will take about half of that again. And I'm just wondering whether the remaining money will be sufficient for us to do any of the other projects, like Rymal Park or any of those, and how we divide that up with Burnside, Paynham and Norwood, with Unley, Walkerville and West Torrens, now that they have seen the prospect bid, will they also formalise bids? And if they submit bids, how are they judged? I mean, what is the criteria, and how do we determine which is best? I mean, is the criteria the quick and the dead, or do we have some process? And so the purpose of this motion is just asking, can we actually have some firm criteria and a way of ensuring that there is alignment with the parkland strategy? Because the risk in all this, and there is significant risk, is that if you're in Walkerville or Unley or some other place, which also have priorities, then we might be seen to be thumbing our nose at those places, those councils, by saying, oh, well, we picked Prospect. We're making a joint bid with them. And so I just asked the members to endorse what would seem like a straightforward process. Let's have some criteria for determining these things.
Councillor Martin, there is a number of inaccurate statements you made, so I'll let the CEO respond.
Yeah, through the chair, just to be really clear, the City of Adelaide has not submitted any proposed prospect project to the state government for funding. City of Adelaide has not done that, has never been requested to do that, has not had anything to do with it. It's not a joint bid. It is simply a request from the City of Prospect to the City of Adelaide, as you've seen in that correspondence. The motion that was agreed to by Council last week was that we engage with the state government and identify if there are any funds available. Certainly the issues that have been raised tonight would form part of the report to Council in due course, no doubt about it. But at this time, I just need to be really clear, there's no submission for funding from City of Adelaide at this time.
All right, Councillor Wilkinson.
Just in seconding this, I think openness and transparency is paramount to what we do as a democracy, as publicly elected people. And I think people in Unley would be looking upon, you know, our decision making in this space and saying, well, you know, obviously there's been some motion from an elected member about something in relation to Prospect Council and North Park lands, and people in the Hunley Council area, which is held by a Liberal person rather than a Labor. But the would be asking questions, why is the council supporting a bid or, you know, spending the government allocation on this area?
Let's be very careful what we're saying in the chamber. I also remind you, we're recorded. So, and I think we would all welcome something from Steve Anley if they've got a good idea. But just,
I think it's important that this is done in an open and transparent way so that we're not seen as supporting any pork barrelling endeavours, so that all can see and that all parties and all adjacent councils have equal opportunity to have some share in the state government money that goes into the parklands, which is intended to benefit all state people, not just people from one side of our boundaries.
Like I said, I'm sure we welcome all councils to give us ideas. Councillor, Deputy Lord Mayor Hendon.
I'm not going to be supporting this for a few reasons, but one, if I can just make the comment first of all, I'm really surprised that Councillor Martin's brought this up again, particularly given what happened at our council meeting last week, when clearly a simple phone call would have resolved this issue, a simple chat with our administration would have resolved this issue rather than bring it into the chamber again. And again, misrepresenting the facts, accidentally or on purpose, I don't know, but clearly misrepresenting the facts about us putting in a bid. We're not putting in Prospect's bid. What's happened is Prospect have shown some interest in the parklands and drawn up some plans. Now, good on them. But that does not in any way detract from our priorities. Our priorities we have set out in our plan for the parklands, in our strategic management plan for the parklands, which we've spent months on. Councillor Martin's been part of those. He knows the priorities we've set them up. There they are, they're all written in there, page one, the top 10 things we want to do. They remain the top 10 things we want to do. And we're working on Marshmallow Park and we're identifying the next ones we can start working on. And that's what we're saying to the state government we want to spend our money on. Prospects come throwing a ball from left field, and obviously we have to, play it with a straight bat. But that doesn't mean it becomes our priority because it's their priority. And I don't think there's any sense from our administration that that's the case. Because I did pick up the phone and ask the question. I did have the conversation. That was certainly the assurances that I was given. So I think, it's just a matter of making some simple inquiries and setting your mind at rest, because I share Councillor Martin's views about their particular issue, but I think the methodology is unsatisfactory. I also can't support it because, and Councillor Martin, this happens a bit in your motions, it includes some facts there that we simply don't know if they're true. You know, having regard to Prospect Council's bids to secure more than $7 million for parklands projects. And I have got no idea whether that is accurate or not.
It's in your documents.
And this is one of the reasons why motions are so much better on notice, because either ask the question or put the motion on notice so that our administration can make some comments on this. And we can get the benefit not just of your beautifully worded question, but also of our administration's articulate and comprehensive response. That's what I want, so that I can make good decisions.
Councillor Moran.
I too might, while completely sharing the sentiment, I mean, I was at that meeting and I didn't see a $7 million bid. So I'm asking you, Chair, why did you accept the motion when it contains, what if this motion gets up? Which you probably won't, but we have to vote it down. I don't think this motion should have been accepted because it has the words Prospect Council's bid to secure more than $7 million for parklands projects on a nearest boundary. If that's not the case, then this motion should not be accepted.
Thanks, Sarah. Look, it's a fair point, but to be honest, after last week's schmozzle and the way in which Councillor Martin conducted himself, which was quite appalling, I think we'll all agree.
I agree with
you.
I
look,
if this is what I turn to, potential.
Do you know what? That's why
I will leave
Councillor Kerr.
Sorry, Councillor.
Excuse me, Councillor Kerr. Excuse me.
If you want to get personal, so will I.
Councillor Clarahan, enough. What I said was that is why I accept, let Councillor Martin put his motion. I think you need to listen.
Don't you start patronising me!
I think you need to listen as to my... I was asked a question by Councillor Moran as to why I accepted this. That was my answer, to let Councillor Martin have his say. That is what I... That's my job. So don't tell me that I've done the wrong thing. I believe I did the right thing, and there's the answer to your question.
Thank you, Chair.
Right. Now I would like to ask. I'd like to ask a question too.
Councillor Antic is next.
Right. Well, put my name down as well.
Right, noted.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Actually, Councillor Hendon covered most of what I had to say about that, including the question about whether or not the $7 billion was actually, which wasn't my recollection. So, no more questions.
So, I did, just to clarify, I did get the CEO to clarify what was the scenario. So, I'm trying to be as transparent as possible here. Councillor Clarahan.
I would like to ask a question of the administration, whether in the council notes a list of projects with the amounts beside them adding up to $7 million exists.
Through the Chair, if I could ask for Director Davidson Park to answer, please.
Through you, Chair, thank you. In an attachment to item 8 on tonight's agenda for this meeting is the draft concept plan, which was developed by the prospect and in discussions with us and some of our staff. Some estimated costs were attached to that in order to assist in quantifying the proposal. So it's attached to the report, and the each element that has been proposed in that concept has an estimated cost against it, which comes to $7.2 million.
Thank you very much. I could have sworn I saw it too.
Thank you.
Well, I think that's different to what the question was asked earlier. But now, Lord Mayor.
Chair, can I ask a question of administration, please? With regards to item 8, which was a recommendation to note, could administration just please advise as to what the next steps would typically be in 2017 regarding this matter?
Thank you, through you, Chair. I would suggest the next steps would be, as per the resolution of Council last week, that we then engage in more detailed conversations with City of Prospect and also with the State Government for any potential additional funding opportunities, which there might be the parklands development fund is one which was suggested. What we would suggest is that we, and I think we discussed that as well last week, that there may be some other funding opportunities. We would also explore if indeed there was any other funding coming from the council.
Thank you, Beth.
Prospect, I mean.
Thank you, Beth. So the operative word there is additional. In as far as the motion from last week was to explore if there were any additional funding opportunities. So there is a Parklands Fund, of course, which I think was circa 2012-2013, which Marshmallow Park is the first project. There are a number, of course, in that respect, Councillor Martin is correct. There are a number of projects which have been worked through the Adelaide Parklands Management Strategy, which are priorities for Council. This one joins that list, that somewhat long list, but the operative word is additional funding opportunities. So look, I'm very happy to just rest with the motion from last week, and I don't support this motion.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Do I have any other speakers? Which is only a couple left. Right, Councillor Martin, to sum up.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I am sorry that there is so much heat around this, but the proposal is reasonable. It is a bid. Whether it's successful or not is another matter. The projects, as I foreshadowed earlier on, are listed. They're in all the papers that everybody received, as are the costings, $7.2 million. And there's also reference to a requirement for additional funds for construction in the parklands, with no reference to where that might come from, though I concede this is a very early proposal. My intention was simply, given this proposal from one council, we do not appear to have any governance model to determine how we deal with any others. And so the motion says, how do we develop an equitable, transparent process? How do we also make sure that those proposals that will inevitably come to us now that Prospect has lodged this expression of interest, a bid if you like, there will be other proposals. How are they all judged? How do we measure them against each other and against primarily the City of Adelaide's interests? That is the paramount interest. It is our draft, or at least our parklands management strategy, and therefore we ought to be in control of it. That's all that seeks to do. There is nothing further in that. I have said nothing inflammatory. I have not condemned a person or an issue. I have just put it all on the table. And I just ask for support. I recognise it probably won't be supported. It just seems sensible.
Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against?
Division.
Division.
Those members voting in favour of the motion, please rise.
Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Martin. Declare against the leader. Right, members, thank you. Do I have any other business? I now seek to exclude the public for item number 15. Can I call for a mover of exclusion, please? Councillor Slammer, seconded Councillor Corbell. All those in favour? Declare that carried. I'll now ask anyone from the public or staff that is not associated with this item to leave and have the doors closed.
Chair by Deputy Lord Mayor Hendon.
And I just wanted to say, I think it's really important that we do acknowledge the achievements of many of the women in our community and acknowledge that it's part of our DNA that we've been leaders in the field in terms of obviously having been the first state to provide, offer, well, to give women the vote, but also to allow them to stand for Parliament. Grace Benny was the first Member of Parliament in Australia, first person elected to a government role in Australia. She was a member of the Brighton Council, and in 2 years' time, that will make 100 years. The other thing is, of course, that it was South Australia, the lobbying of South Australian women to the Constitutional Commission that ensured women elsewhere in Australia were able to be given the vote. They persuaded members of the South Australian Commission not to go ahead with that movement unless it guaranteed women of Australia were given the vote, as South Australian women already had the vote. And here we've got, with the recommendation here for Heather Southcott, to acknowledge the fact that she was the first female leader of a political party in Australia. So I think that just continues on with acknowledging the important place that South Australian women have had in governance, in government in Australia.
Thank you, Councillor Clohan. Deputy Lord Mayor Hender in seconding that. Any further discussion on the topic? Would you like to sum up, Councillor Clohan? Those in favour? Those opposed? Carried. Thank you, members. Item 8, provision of public toilets and changing places. Lord Mayor Martin Hayes.
Thank you very much, Chair. Members, I move the motion, the recommendation is printed as a motion, please.
And second by Councillor Clohan.
Thank you, Councillor Clohan. Members, I speak specifically to items 2 and 3 in the recommendation or the motion. Is that members would recall some months ago that I sought a report from administration with regards to the condition and the quantity of public toilet facilities around the City of Adelaide, Parklands included, North Adelaide included. And in doing so, some commentary with regards to the provision of changing places facilities. Now, members would know that changing places facilities are for those who are severely disabled. And we have only one of these facilities in our portfolio, I guess. We've got 50 public conveniences throughout the City of Adelaide, Parklands included, and only one would be possibly construed as a changing place, and that, Chair, is located in the Aquatic Centre. So the point number one really just talks to a bit of an infrastructure audit, and I'm sure that will inform council budgeting moving forward, CEO. With regards to maintenance and the number of our public facilities throughout the City of Adelaide. But I'm more interested in item 2 and 3. And this is about public changing places. Members, I meet every 2 to 3 months with Kelly Vincent, MLC, at Parliament House, and we just talk shop about all things disability. And you would know, members, our discussion around essential infrastructure with a value add, and that's a discussion we've had as a council team in the past. And value add is about improving access for those with disabilities and a whole range of things. But if you look at this through that lens, we currently, for a severely disabled person to use a toilet facility in the City of Adelaide currently, they have one. They have one, and it is located at the Aquatic Centre. And I believe the Central Market is doing a disabled toilet, but I'm not sure if it's at the full specification of what you'd call a changing place. Changing Place has a hoist and various other facilities. So what I got thinking about, members, was is there an opportunity for modelled off very successful programs that we have, like the HIS, the Historic Incentive Scheme, the SIS, the Sustainability Incentive Scheme, whereby we incentivise others to do things in the marketplace. Whether there's an opportunity for administration to put back to us a changing places incentive scheme or something similar, Chair, which would incentivise shopping centre owners, apartment developers and others who are, and those who own existing or are building new buildings, to include a change in places in their infrastructure, in their building. In parallel to that, we could also consider one of our own to lead by example. So this recommendation, this motion, members, talks to all of that. This would come back to this council, but this is the next step on from doing that audit of toilet and bathroom and changing places facility in the City of Adelaide, which administration did a great job of over the last 3 months. But this is the next logical step. Other cities have this. Many other capital cities have changing places facilities provided by local governments. I'm unsure whether any other capital cities have an incentive scheme, but to me that sounds fairly clever. It's a way of sharing the load with the private sector to incentivise them. So as an example, Chair, you might have a shopping centre in Rundle Mall who, if they knew that we had an incentive scheme, they may then look towards putting this facility into their shopping centre and adding that to their infrastructure, which is important. So members, I know that you all pride yourselves on leading a very inclusive city. This is a part of the infrastructure required. I must say it's a little embarrassing that we don't already do this. I think we're playing catch-ups to some degree. I think we should be doing this, and I commend this to you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Before we move to the Senator, Councillor Clarahan, because we're about to turn into a pumpkin, I will ask for a mover to adjourn. Councillor Shaw, seconded by Councillor Martin. Those in favour, adjourn. Those in favour, those opposed, we now adjourn to enable the opening of the next committee, the Economic and Community Development Committee.
I declare the Economic and Community Development Committee of the 6th of December open and seek a mover for an adjournment. Moved by Councillor Corbell, seconded by Councillor Antic. Can I put that? All those in favour? That's carried. And I therefore adjourn the meeting.
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Now come back to Councillor Clarahan. We reconvene the Infrastructure Committee. Come back to Councillor Clarahan, the second of that motion forward by the Lord Mayor.
Yes, look, I'm happy to support this. I think someone said to me that there are 13 changing places in Hobart. And we only have one, which really indicates we're behind the eight ball quite a bit here, aren't we? And I also think that we need to acknowledge that we really don't supply sufficient, not only the condition of toilets, but needs attention, but also there are still calls for people using our facilities for extra toilets. And I cite the women's club at the North Adelaide golf course wanting a toilet on an extra toilet on the course, and we still haven't responded to that. So I would welcome this particular investigation, and also would welcome in looking at whether we can encourage others in their developments to provide changing places facilities through an incentive, or alternatively liaise with even the state government to look at whether we could have one placed at the Adelaide railway station. They're basic facilities, and we need to ensure that we're covering up on those very basic local government roles.
Thank you, Councillor Clare. Do we have any dissenting views? Councillor Corbell, and then Councillor Martin.
I've got a question of the administration, and then I'd like to move an amendment. The question is, in the new Royal Adelaide Hospital site, given that this document speaks to public toilets and publicly accessible toilets, in the new Royal Adelaide Hospital site, or even in the existing Royal Adelaide Hospital site, are there any publicly accessible accredited changing spaces toilets?
That to administration, thank you.
Through your chair, we'll have to take that on notice. We don't know at this point in time, so we're happy to come back to you.
Thank you. All right, just as a comment in passing, I think I would be personally surprised if the state government had invested millions and millions of dollars in building a new hospital facility
billions.
And hadn't considered putting in an accredited changing toilet in their new facility. Okay, I'd like to move an amendment, which is an additional point, that the Lord Mayor and or CEO liaises with relevant state government departments and ministers with regard to possible contributions of funding towards this project, in particular to establish an accredited changing places toilet facility in the City of Adelaide. And I seek a second.
Do we have a second? Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. There has been some discussion about the role of state government and the role of city council. I believe we both play a role, and establishing a changing spaces toilet is going to be costly. And I recall, it was either earlier this year or last year, it came through, and the project that was recommended was it was over $1 million from memory, significantly expensive. So with due respect, this motion seeks for state government possible sources of funding for the upgrading of our public toilet facilities, which according to the report, many of which are dated, there's about 50 public toilets within our public realm that are public toilets or publicly accessible, and many of them are built in the 1960s and 70s. So we do need to upgrade our facilities in general overall, and in particular this one costly project of changing spaces toilet is very, very important, and I think it's well overdue, but there might be possible opportunities for state government funding.
As chair, I'll just ask for a clarification about the $1 million cost, if there's any clarification. Is that
was for the recommendation.
Just to inform the committee. Do you have any answer to that question?
Yes, certainly. And through the chair, that was a very specific project. Because of the configuration of a changing places, it can't actually replace the DDA toilet that's currently there. So there was a lot of building costs that were in as part of that project. So the delivery of the actual changing places component would not be of that sort of dollar value.
Yeah. Okay, just on that clarification, I recognise as the mover of this amendment that project referred to in James Place was not, it was the project overall cost was over $1 million, but to establish a change in places toilet facility wouldn't necessarily cost that, but still it is a substantial cost. And it would be ideal if we could get more. We do have a non-accredited changing places space in the Aquatic Centre, but it's not accessible at all times. The Central Markets is going to have one, but again, it's not accredited, it's not up to standard. We need to have an accredited facility, a changing places facility within the city, and actually it would be better if we could have more than one. So if we could get some state government funding, then
that
would be really helpful.
Thank you, Councillor Cadell. Councillor Martin, seconding that?
Yes, I support this. And I note that in the background information at paragraph 29, there is an example of a mobile changing places facility that was constructed in Maroondah, Victoria, with the assistance of that state's government. I am aware that there is disability funding available through various state government budgets, but I'd also ask the administration, without amending this, to consider also federal funding, which is also available. These are clearly avenues.
And the variation could
be. Well, it's up to the mover. If the mover.
I'm happy for the variation to strengthen.
Yeah. Yep. Can we ask the mover if
they
accept that? And the seconder?
Yep. I think the point is made that,
Okay, I put that variation, those in favour of that variation, the federal funding we sought. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think the point has been made that state and federal governments may well assist us in developing changing places toilets and also publicly accessible changing places toilets. But I'd also ask the administration to consider that state and federal governments may also party with other groups, including building owners, shopping centres and the like, in developing those facilities as the Lord Mayor proposed as some kind of incentive scheme. So it's certainly worth making those inquiries and seeing if the funding's available.
Thank you, Councillor
Andy. Thank you, Chair. Can I just ask a question? We talk about changing places toilets. Is this pardon my ignorance, I've seen the photographs. Is this just colloquially what used to be referred to as a disabled toilet facility?
No.
Is it a higher
level? Ground, they're disabled.
Okay.
Cranes.
Yeah, okay. All right. No, that's all. Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, I saw the photo.
Do we have any further discussion on that amendment? Can I put that amendment? All those in favour of the amendment? That's carried. Thank you, those carried. Thank you. And I come back to the substantive. Lord Mayor, sum up.
Thanks, Chair. And summing up, I thank Councillor Corbell for that amendment because I think that does enable us to fully explore points 1, 2, and now 3 and 4 on this. And I think we can do these all in parallel. So I think it's really important, members, that we, and thank you for supporting this. I'll relay this to Kelly Vincent, MLC, who I know will be very excited to hear this. But this is kind of essential infrastructure for our city, for those with a severe disability. It doesn't negate the fact that we need disabled toilets throughout the city of Adelaide. We've got them, we need them, we must maintain them. It doesn't negate the fact that we need many other toilet facilities throughout the city of Adelaide. This is a very specialist need, which is evidently growing through the research that I've done. And in terms of cost, a little bit of desktop research showed that there was a private operator who delivered one of these for $55,000 recently in Western Australia, but I think they're really dependent upon their size and their format and the complexity and the, you know, everything else. So it's certainly not a $1 million project, but it's something that we, of course, should, I think, kind of hop to it and get to work on. So thanks for your support, members. Appreciate it. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I put that. Those in favour? Those opposed? That's carried. A very worthy project there. I now move on to items for committee to receive and note. There are nil. That's item 10. Our session papers for committee to receive and note. There are nil. Other business. Any other business members? There being no other business. Item 12, exclusion of public. Item 12 pertains to item 13, and I've been advised by administration and as chair of this committee that that report will be put to another subsequent meeting. So we will move straight through those to the closure, and I declare the introductory committee closed at 7:00.
Thank you. I've never done fix this and do not jinx it.
Don't make it.
Do not.
I promise.
Next. Yes, that's echo.
Members, I declare the Economic and Community Development Committee meeting reopened and begin with the acknowledgement of country, indicating that we, this committee, acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pay our respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people meeting today. We have no apologies or leave of absence, so I've moved straight to the confirmation of minutes. Can I have someone move? Moved by Councillor Clarahan, seconded by the Lord Mayor. Can I put that? All those in favour, that's carried. We have no public forum, no chair's verbal report. So items for adoption on block. Item 9, out of session information papers to note. So can I have someone move item 9, moved by the Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Malani. Can I put item 9, all those in favour, that's carried. That brings us to item 10, a motion on notice by the Lord Mayor.
Thank you very much, Chair. I move as printed and I seek a seconder.
Seconded by Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Members, the last event which we held in the Queen Adelaide Room before it was closed for its refurbishment, which is currently happening, we'll be able to enjoy that room again early next year, was an event which we held for long-term City of Adelaide residents, which I must say was a great event, and well done, members, for supporting that. And it's and in a parallel discussion I've had with the Lord Mayor of Hobart, Lord Mayor Sue Hickey, who was sharing with me that they have a series of town hall open days in the city of Hobart, and it kind of got me thinking and it got me again investigating what other capital city councils at least do. But Members, as you know, I'm fairly passionate about opening this building up for the public. At the moment, unless you are coming in here to meet with a member or to meet with certainly town hall component, to meet with an elected member of Adelaide City Council, or you're coming in here to pay for something, meaning pay for a show or go to a show in the auditorium or the banqueting room, you don't really have an opportunity to come in and learn about town hall. And it got me thinking, members, that there's a great opportunity in front of us to have an annual town hall open day, which might be on a Saturday. I'm very open to administration's advice as to when the best time would be to do this. Hence, I'm calling for a report, is that we can open up this building on one day a year if we deem that to be applicable. It could be on a weekend. The members could get involved in some capacity should we wish, and people could join us here at Town Hall to learn about the history of this building. And I think this is a building, members, which we need to celebrate. 150 years old, this building, 1866. A lot has happened. It's a centre of our decision making. It's our workplace, but it's also a community building. It's a civic asset. We don't own it. We're the custodians of it. So I'm always a great advocate that we should be opening up the doors of Town Hall more, so that more people can say, I've seen the council chamber, I've seen the Queen Adelaide room, I've seen the auditorium, I've been taken on a tour, I've learned who's visited this building in the past, whatever it might be. So I think it's fairly self-explanatory. I'm not going to labour it. I look for your support, members. I think it's a great idea. I think it's part of our opening this building up to our community. It just seems to make imminent sense, and I'm surprised that we don't already do it. So I look for your support.
Anyone else wish to speak on this?
Just that I think it's probably overdue, because there's a lot of the other institutions that do open day, schools, universities, religious institutions like churches, in Government House. So I think it's a positive thing. It can bring people to our town hall, and I think everyone should support it.
Councillor Wilkinson?
Don't we already run tours, which are open to the public, that provide this openness?
Indeed we do, but I think that what the Lord Mayor is suggesting is that it might be a bit more behind the scenes activities, and it also could be that the councillors and other staff members might be in here and participate in the tours, and that they'll see a more working room rather than historical experience.
Okay, thank you.
Perhaps we can have a meeting for
them. We could indeed, we could have a mock meeting. Members, anybody else wish to speak to this? Lord Mayor, summed up?
Summed up, Chair.
So can I put it, all those in favour? That is carried. Thank you. That brings us to item 11, other business. Do we have any other business? Yes, please.
Not please. My question is, can administration provide a time frame for the provision of a report in relation to the development of 211 Pirie Street, being the City Beach volleyball site, and provide a summary of the possible development opportunities and returns to ratepayers which will arise from the development of that site? Yes.
Through you, Chair. Thank you for the question. The answer is that we'll be providing reports to the February Economic Development, or probably Infrastructure and Planning Committee, which will actually, the committee, thank you, that will actually detail the information that's been requested, including potential development scenarios, opportunities to the site and the like. So February next year will be when that report is provided.
Yeah, and just to supplement that, so will that report provide a summary of the possible returns to ratepayers from?
Yes, at a sort of conceptual or principle level,
yeah.
not a detailed analysis, because it will ultimately depend on what development scenario the council wants to pursue, which will then further investigate, but certainly will give some indicative returns to the ratepayer from those various development scenarios.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Antic. Any other business? Any other business? No? Well, that brings us to item 12, which is a motion to exclude. Moved by Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Moran. All those in favour of motion to exclude? All those in favour, members, are you voting? Yep, thank you. That is carried. Now, before we move to item, asking any member of the public or member of our administration who are not involved with item 13 to please leave the gallery and leave the room and ask the door be closed. Thank you. Before we move to item
I ask for those two members that have left the meeting to return and at 7:40 p.m. close this economic and community development meeting.
Construction of the pontoon and on the purchase of lease.
Members, thank you. I think we're travelling well. We've got a quorum. So I'll declare the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting open on 6th of December 2016, reopened at 7:41 p.m. And the Finance and Business Services Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on traditional country, the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, and that we pay respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and a relationship with the land, and we recognise their continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. We don't have any apologies or legal absence. Can I have someone move the confirmation of the minutes in item 3, moved by the Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. Any debate, changes or discussion? Be it none, I put that. All those in favour? All those against? Item 3 is carried. There is no public forum. There is no Chair's verbal report, with the exception that this potentially could be the last committee meeting of this council, if we're resolved in this order. So we'll see what happens next in the new year, potentially.
Of this committee.
Items for adoption on block. So item 7, 2017-18 integrated business plan process. Item 8, procurement policy endorsement. Item 9, governance framework, Councillor Maloney. There was no pullouts. Oh, did you? Sorry. Councillor Mutt, did you have your hand up on item 8?
I did.
Okay. Councillor Maloney, item 9. Excellent. Item 10, quarterly forward procurement report. Item 11, council rating and revenue review.
Yep.
Sorry, Deputy Lord Mayor. There is no out of session papers. Committee receives nil. So can I have someone move item 7, 10 and 12? Moved by the Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Virchow. Any debate or discussion? Be it none, I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against? Those items are carried. I'll move to item 8. Councillor Martin, do you have a motion?
I might have actually. Would you move it?
I'm happy to move it as printed.
So we'll have the Deputy Lord Mayor's moving item 8. Councillors, can I have a seconder, please? Seconded by Councillor Maloney. Deputy Lord Mayor, reserve your right. Councillor Maloney?
Reserve my right.
Councillor Martin?
Look, I will foreshadow an amendment, and it is simply in relation to the diminished role for elected members in the procurement process. What this proposal does through the attachment is quadruple the amount that the CEO or the administration effectively is able to approve without bringing before council. So currently the level is 1, and this proposes increasing it to 4. That is $4 million
which is an awful lot of money. It is, in fact, easily some of the projects that we've launched here in council. They would include some of the significant asset projects, but also in terms of just everyday income, it's sort of, you know, it is the income of two average working people for their entire life. So it's a lot of money. It is also considerably more than I would have felt comfortable with had it just been proposed as an increase. For example, if two was proposed, that is a doubling of the authority, then I feel quite comfortable supporting that on the basis that I'd give it a go. But quadrupling the amount from $1 million to $4 million, and then as a consequence, council, the elected body, does not have oversight of those amounts under that, except in certain circumstances, does make me feel uncomfortable. And so I would like to propose that the amount be reduced to $2 million. It is not an onerous thing for council to continue to be asked to approve such things. And indeed, there's a perfect illustration tonight on page 55. You can see the matters that have been brought to us within the procurement schedule for purchase. And it's gone through. You've already approved it, but you've had oversight of it. You had the chance to have a look at it.
So, Councillor, I apologise, I've let you speak, but do you have a second for that?
I'm happy to second that.
Seconded by Councillor Carnahan. I've also got a, I'll just wait for Councillor Martin to finish. The CEO has got a point of clarification, but I'm happy for you to complete your 5 minutes, Councillor.
No, I'm happy for the CEO to speak.
Are you prepared to do? Okay, not a problem, we'll do that. So we've got a comment from the CEO.
Through you, Chair, just a point of clarification. Administration can only spend in accordance with budget provisions. And that is the case. So whilst there may be a suggested increase in the ceiling, we would only spend in accordance with budget provisions.
Councillor Martin.
Nevertheless, thank you very much, Deputy Lord Mayor. Nevertheless, it seems to me that if $2 million is the figure that the City of Melbourne allows its CEO to expend without the authority of the elected body, then it's not an unreasonable proposition for us. Now, I do note that some councils have unlimited authority to their CEO, and I point out that those councils are, in most instances, with the exception of the City of Brisbane, smaller than us. But the City of Brisbane has other restraints which are identified in this document, including the length of the contracts that are entered into. We have no such provisions outlined to us in this documentation presented to us, merely a request to increase the amount to $4 million. And so I just urge members to support the prudent prudential path, and that is approve a doubling by all means, but not a quadrupling.
So, Councillor Joanne is the seconder. Any other speakers? Councillor.
I've looked at the deliberations that this council has gone through dealing with a $280,000 crossing in Whitmore Square. You know, clearly the elected body is concerned about how, you know, that order of money is spent. So I would have thought it's fit to have it increase from $1 million to $4 million when council gets her involved in the $280,000 Whitmore Square pedestrian crossing. I think is indicative of what's proportionate. So I would have $1 million, but certainly $2 million is better than quadrupling the current arrangement.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. I've got a comment from Stephen in relation to this as well.
Through the Chair. I guess from the operational perspective of the organisation in relation to the CEO's delegation, it really is reasonably contemporary for most organisations to accept that through their policy that the budget decision-making has identified the funds and allocation of funds in relation to key projects. So once there is actually an adopted budget, this is proposing...
Steve, do you mind deciding, Councillor Maloney, please, full attention. No. Important. I need to know. I've got other council members that are concerned about it, so I need to address it. Thank you. Please continue.
As the CEO mentioned before, is that it would be in relation to items where council has already had a line of sight to the budget formation and the orders of magnitude of the budget. There's always the potential for council through any process to request or seek or resolve to have an item brought specifically to the chamber. This is a reasonably contemporary threshold, as we're identifying that there's $4 million within adopted budgets. Given also that the items further in the agenda that have been pulled out for discussion shortly talk about council rationalising its civic governance framework, and we have talked in different forums with you about how do we actually make that operationally more efficient and effective within the chamber, these are the sorts of delegations that will actually assist in achieving that. Noting again specifically that council can bring forward any items that it specifically identifies to report to the chamber.
Thank you. Lord Mayor, your agenda.
I did, Chair, I'm comfortable with the recommendation of $4 million. I think we've got, and I was questioned through administration, projects which I understand are in the vicinity of $4.5 million or above require a prudential report. Is that correct, CEO?
Through the Chair, that is correct. That's the figure.
Okay, so this is bringing that approval for the CEO, that delegated authority for the CEO, closer to the prudential report limit. If we look at other LGAs such as Onkaparinga, Charles Sturt, Marion and Salisbury, it's unlimited, it's in line with their budget approval process. I think if Tetri Galley have $4 million already in terms of budgets, they're a smaller council than we are. $4 million would be about 2% of this council's annual operating revenue, including rates and other business services. I'm comfortable with this $4 million threshold. I think so. We get our opportunity for plenty of checks and balances through the budget approval process, and I think we then entrust our CEO getting on the job with the job. So I'm comfortable with this. So I don't support the $2 million threshold. I'm comfortable with the four.
Councillor Cooper.
Thank you, Chair. Just a question. I might have missed something. When was it set at $1 million? What year?
1963.
I'm not sure that we can actually answer that definitively unless Mr. Gray can.
Through the Chair, I can't answer that. Sorry.
Okay, well that's interesting in itself because I'm sure that with the people in this room there's many, many years experience on the City Council, so even that in itself speaks that it's not a contemporary figure, and this proper recommendation brings it back in line with, I think, what it should be, more contemporary. I do support this, I don't support the amendment.
Councillor Maloney.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I know it's important, Madam, and I don't support the amendment either, because what we're trying to do is being an enabler. We're trying to work to modern-day policies that create decision-making and enable us to get on with business. So that is why I support the recommendation as it's printed.
Councillor Slammer. Sorry, I put you at the end up. Councillor Clarahan, as the seconder.
Look, I can understand how it would reduce red tape, etc. But I would also acknowledge that we're under a new regime, we've got a new team, and to go from 1 million to 4 million, I find, is a jump too far. And I would prefer that we go halfway and that we review it in, say, 12 months' time or 2 years' time. But I just find the jump from 1 million to 4 million too big a leap.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Martin, sum up.
Look, I just remind members that though it's suggested that this is, you know, just 2% of our budget, $4 million represents more than 10% of our asset renewal budget every year. It represents more than we give to organisations for the purposes of funding events like the festival and so on through that budget. It is multiple times more what we give to sporting organisations and the like. It is a very substantial sum of money. And the amendment is simply saying that we as elected members are expected to be or at least have oversight of the financial operations of the organisation. In that sense, it is just a prudent measure, and I recommend it to everyone. It's just a sensible move.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. And members, are putting the amendment of Councillor Martin that's before you there on the projector. I put that. All those in favour of the amendment? All those against? That is lost.
Division?
Division is being called.
Those members voting in favour of the amendment, please rise. Councillor Cooper. Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Carrihan, Councillor Martin.
So now we're dealing with the substantive. Can we put that as well? Councillor Moran, you happy with that? Okay, so I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against? That is also carried. We will move on to item 9, Councillor Mulani.
Thank you, Chair. I move as printed with one minor amendment to, I think I'm going to put it in 5, to add a 5.3.
Can we skip that, the words from that?
Yeah, that if successful post 6-month trial period, that the chair be rotated every 3 months amongst the elected members. It talks about chairing for the trial period, but
what was it suggesting?
3 months
in the report.
Well, it's suggesting 3 months, January.
So then everyone gets to go chairing, basically.
So that's seconded by Councillor Moran.
Thank you. I think this is an exciting opportunity for us to trial a new governance arrangement. Whilst we've had these four committees for some time, and what we have really identified is the opportunity for us to be able to workshop certain items without being in too many parameters around having that open discussion. So I think giving this a trial, it is a 6-month trial, and a review will be undertaken and we can decide from then. Obviously, the committees that will remain, stay unchanged, such as Audit Committee, Reconciliation Committee, DAP, ACMA, etc. So I really thank the administration for putting a lot of hard work into this report. It seems pretty thorough to me, and the only way we're really going to know if it's an improvement is to trial it. And I think that's the opportunity that positions us all in front, and that's positioned in front of you all. We're wanting to have good, robust debate. We want to have frank and fearless advice. We want to have workshop-style conversations where everyone can contribute. And then we leave the formal side of it to the chamber. And I think we're still having two council meetings a month, so we get that fast decision making. Because at the end of the day, we all want fast decision making that enables, but we want it to be quality. So my understanding is this workshop will give the opportunity for all elected members to contribute. The staff then, administration will then go away, take all that feedback on board to then develop what would be the ultimate recommendation. And I think actually would save a lot of paperwork, to be honest, and time. And it also gets everyone's views on the table before something is actually positioned to us as a final recommendation. So I urge you all to give it a go. I think it will be a lot more inclusive in terms of conversation, and I do think it will be far more efficient. So I urge you all to support the motion.
Councillor Moran.
I'll reserve my right.
So we have the, Councillor Virchow, followed by Councillor Martin, followed by Councillor Wilkinson and the Lord Mayor.
Thank you. I support the motion and the amendment. I just want to clarify 4.1. Can I just check that the word policy isn't missing from the Strategic Planning and Development Policy Committee?
What page are you on, Sandy?
Yes, sorry. It is missing, so that needs to be fixed. So let's just do with this as a variation, members. So development, item 4.1 appoints the Lord Mayor and all councillors to Strategic Planning and Development Policy Committee. Can I get seek leave to vary from members?
Yeah.
Can I get show hands? Yeah. Thank you. That's done. That's a vary. Thank you, Councillor.
That's right. Besides, that shows you I read my papers. Besides that, I agree. I'm really interested as to how it's going to work. There's part of me that thinks that it might be an interesting trial period. But I also support it because there's been many a time where the debate has happened in the committee and people come to public galleries within the council chambers and we simply go yes, 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 and that's it and we're done. And that really actually needs to be, it's not a good demonstration to our public as to how the decision's made. So I support it and I look forward to it.
Councillor Martin.
Yeah, look, I have a series of questions. Some of this has been discussed in workshops, but some of this is absolutely brand new. I've never seen it before. And the first question is, it's proposed that the number of members required for a quorum will be reduced from 7 to 5. Now, my question is, if you have a presiding member and a deputy presiding member, is it correct you only then need 3 councillors in the room, 5 elected members in total to make up a quorum?
For the committee.
For committee.
No, I understand.
Workshop, for the workshop.
Well, that's the next question. Is that the case for committee?
Through the presiding member, that's certainly the suggestion. So the quorum is 5, so that includes the chair or the deputy chair and 3 other members. That's certainly the suggestion for committee on it.
And that doesn't apply to council?
No, not at all.
Okay. Well, it's just that we refer backwards and forwards to committee and council, and therefore it's hard to understand. Now, it's proposed to allow the presiding member to speak without leave from the meeting of committee or council or both?
Through the presiding member, so that provision can be provided for both. So both the committee and the council, there is the ability to exercise an existing provision within the meeting regulations to do that.
So is it correct then to say that council meetings will change to the extent that the Lord Mayor is then able to enter into a debate within the chamber while making impartial judgments about the application of standing orders?
Through the presiding member, so 17.1 provides advice around the ability for the presiding member, be that the Lord Mayor or the chair of the committee, to exercise an existing provision within the meeting regulations to speak prior to that moving something up. The mover summing up, because under the City of Adelaide Act, but also the Local Government Act, they do have a responsibility or they do have a role as a council member to participate, but they also have a unique role as being the presiding member as well.
It was discussed also in workshops that the chair would be rotated each week, and I noticed that Councillor Malani's picked that up after 6 months. Why did the administration not adopt that in the trial for the 3-month periods?
Through the presiding member, our recommendation was to enable some stability of chair. So the suggestion was to the council for the chair role to be rotated on a quarterly basis so the administration can work with the chair in a similar way to that which we do now in terms of planning the agenda and the approach, so that there is some consistency. That's our recommendation to you for your consideration.
And it was suggested in previous meetings that there be no payment to the chair as there is for current committees. Is there a payment, because it's not identified in here, for the presiding member of committee?
Yes, so through the presiding member, the Remuneration Tribunal, they actually establish payments to council members and in fact to the chair of the committee. So assuming that the person that is the chair is not the deputy or mayor at that particular point in time, they receive an allowance which is 1.25 times the current allowance of council members.
Okay, but that only excludes the Deputy Lord Mayor.
Correct. So if the Deputy Lord Mayor was to chair, the Deputy Lord Mayor doesn't get an additional allowance.
And the administration in any of the workshops has never, at any occasion that I know of, proposed reducing the time allowed to members of the public to present to public forums, reducing it from 5 to 3 minutes, nor for elected members.
Again, that was merely a suggestion from the administration in terms of the way you as a council may wish to use your meeting time. That's our recommendation to you for your consideration.
Okay, thank you. Chair, look, I won't be supporting this because this is a really substantial change to the role of the Lord Mayor. It suggests that as part of the process of providing impartial judgments during the course of debates in council. The Lord Mayor can enter the debate, and there is nothing in there that suggests how that might happen. Whether, in fact, he can intervene because he thinks it's going the wrong way, whether he can intervene because he doesn't like, you know, what you're saying, or alternatively, whether he can sum up and dismiss everything that's being presented. It creates a really substantial change and makes that role much more political, in my view, unless, of course, the incumbent prefers to exercise an independence, which is not required, in what's proposed here. And additionally, I think the really challenging thing in all of this is selling to the public that we are reducing the number of people required for a quorum to around 42% of the elected membership. Now, seven elected members has generally been regarded as a pretty poor turnout, and I can remember the extent to which we had to run around and try and get seven people here on occasions. But five would just fill a Camry, and frankly, it won't fill ratepayers with confidence that we're serious about the job of running this organisation if we only have a Camry load turning up.
It's important you know, councillor, it's the workshop, not council. I don't want this to be recorded in public as
I understand.
We're reducing our commitment to councillors.
I understand. This is the context in which we are talking, and it is a formal body of council which will workshop and discuss and relate argument about a whole range of issues in preparation for the council meeting at which a decision will be taken. If all that's required is five people, then there's a very good chance that that is the number which will attend. And the other thing is, I just can't support the notion that it is a fair deal for ratepayers to journey across town to come and talk to us about something important on the promise that we'll give them a few minutes. Currently, we provide them with 5 minutes. It's a reasonable grant to the ratepayers of this city that they have the opportunity to expand on an argument, and 5 minutes is not unreasonable. It is also not unreasonable for elected members. If it were 3 minutes, and as much as some people here would like that, if it were 3 minutes, the bell would have gone off for me a few minutes ago. I understand that.
You have single-handedly caused that.
Well, look, in that case, if, as Councillor Moran says, the decision is being taken by council on the basis of one councillor, then it's pretty poor decision making, because the standing order is established for all councillors and for posterity until it's changed. Now, these are really long-term serious issues which have not been debated. They have not been discussed at workshop. And so, look, well, I understand that, but we have had specific workshops for the purposes of discussing all of these measures, half of which, in my understanding, have not been traversed. There has not been the opportunity to examine them and discern whether there are good points or bad points. It is now in the form of a motion to go towards council, and I will be voting against it.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Wilkinson, then the Lord Mayor.
Yes, but the reason why I stood for council was not to not waste other councillors and staff's time by basically voting yes to whatever's put up. I feel that the sentiment of this whole move is towards basically diminishing the opportunity for elected members through their contribution to debate from 5 minutes to 3 minutes. The opportunity to actually reflect on important decisions. The thing is, not much time is really spent in rehashing issues unless they actually do need to be rehashed. And then with the current format, that opportunity is there. So I'm sure that I could see some councillors writing fervently, taking no interest in what I'm saying, which reflects that some people would rather just go in, out, yes, 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 yes. Well, why are we on council if that's our attitude to sitting around this table? I'm here because I care about what happens in the city and I want to be involved and I'm interested and I'm prepared to be persuaded, others clearly aren't, that I want to be able to be persuaded by the views put up by other people, and I want them to have their fair time to speak it. And I want to have our current forum where we get to discuss it in committee and stuff like that, and then we get to sanction it in council. I mean, the only sort of a lament that I have about the current thing is that, you know, when we get to council, there's not the necessarily the debate, but sometimes it is when it does come up. And then it is the contentious issues, then it does come up in the full council. And I've also heard it lamented by the chair and others that one of the concerns about the current system is that the media get a double grab. But in my, I am a ratepayer as a business owner, but I'm a ratepayer in the Norwood Council. The only way I know what the Norwood Council is up to is by reading in the Messenger. What's wrong with having the media reporting and having a double grab at what we're saying? That's how our constituents and the people that we represent actually get to hear about the decisions we're making on their behalf. So I'm not into sidelining that kind of process, cutting down, you know, my apologies for speaking for more than 3.1 minutes. But, you know, like, I didn't get on council just to be curtailed like that. And also when our constituents come to represent themselves, go to all of that effort, to them to be shut down. Oh, and I know we have one in particular, you know, ratepayer who's problematic, and we'd love to shut her down perhaps to 1 minute. But for the sake of something like that, or because some people might perceive that, you know, one or two councillors speak longer than they should we be changing entire setup just because some people are a bit, you know, aggrieved or angsty about the fact that some people take longer than they should, or, you know, I mean, I'm concerned about our democratic sort of system that we have, and I'm not really feeling that there's that much broken about the current system. I think it's good that the media get the double grab at what we're talking about. That's healthy, that's democracy, and that our constituents, then that, and all the elected members and others are clearly not interested in what I'm saying, but that I hope that most are, that's what we're about. So I'm not comfortable with this change. I think we've actually got a fairly good system as we have it, and so I won't be supporting the report as before.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Lord Mayor, then Councillor Corbell, and Councillor Moran.
Chair, can I?
Sorry, apologies.
Chair, can I just check, please? Did Councillor Maloney move a alternate motion from the outset, or an amendment?
No, I moved the substantive.
You moved the substantive. Okay. So, members, I generally support the provisions of what we've got recommended before us, and I'll just speak to Councillor Martin's words, and then I'm going to propose an amendment, members. Councillor Martin's words about this, the Lord Mayor. Now, if without this new committee structure, of course, no one will be moving motions in a committee level, which effectively then gives the Lord Mayor no voice. So I think it's quite reasonable to expect members that the Lord Mayor should be able to enter the debate. The Local Government Act provides for it, the City of Adelaide Act provides for it. It's actually just our own current standing orders that don't provide for it. Most local governments throughout South Australia enable their Lord Mayor to debate from the chair. We are actually the exception, we're not the norm under what we've done. So this rectifies that. I think you've got to rely on your Lord Mayor to exercise discretion. I mean, as your presiding member, I wouldn't come out of the bat off the bat with an issue. My first hat would be to be your presiding member. My second lens would be to enter the debate if I'm particularly passionate about that matter, but I would hold back and do that towards the end before the summer. And I think you just have to have some trust that that is the fact. That is how many of the 68 LGAs around South Australia do it, actually, Chair. So we are the exception, we are not the norm. And secondly, I won't be able to move a motion, which of course I can currently in committee. So if I want to move a motion under this new structure, I would need to do it through a fellow elected member. I'm accepting of that. I'm actually comfortable with that. If I've got something I'm particularly passionate about, I will work through my fellow elected members to get that up to the chamber.
That's the same structure currently, Lord Mayor.
Well, I can move a motion in committee, Chair.
In council, it doesn't count.
But in council, it doesn't. Correct. You're absolutely right. So, but however, I just counter Councillor Martin's comments. I mean, you can't have a Lord Mayor with no voice. I mean, you just can't do it. That's anti-democratic, surely. However, I do move an amendment, Chair, and it's particularly with regards to items 6.2 and 6.3. I don't support 3-minute speaking times for deputations or for members. I don't. I think it's insufficient for what is required to debate a matter. I hope we don't always need to use our full complement of 5 minutes.
So, Lord Mayor, just to get clarity, I think you're sort of speaking to it and amending. So
I'm happy to include
the
that.
Notion is to strike it out.
Yeah.
To strike out the three.
Would you be happy to vary?
I'd be happy to vary.
Thank you,
to vary. So just to give a clarity to the room, we are varying back the strike out, so it's status quo, 5 minutes.
And the next one?
So just firstly...
Thank you.
So and, just and, to get... So you've got another one, Lord Mayor?
Yes, I do, Chair.
Okay.
Yeah. Chair, the other one is the court...
Just 1 second, let me deal with both of them together.
Thanks, Councillor Maloney. The other one, members, is the quorum matter. I think it should be at 7, because I think effectively we're incentivising councillors not to turn up. I'm really passionate about this. We've been elected to do a job.
So, Lord Mayor, you're debating it again. I just need to get that clear.
Sorry,
you're happy to take that on board?
I would like it to remain at 7.
Okay, so we're basically striking...
Everything else I'm happy with.
Councillor, Lord Mayor, just 1 second, please, to make this very clear. So we're striking the 6.2 provision, the 6.3 provision, leaving status quo, which basically indicates 5 minutes to speak for councillors, 5 minutes for public deputations and forums, and also striking back for the committee structure of 7 instead of 5. Councillor Maloney, you're happy to support this as the mover?
Correct, yes.
Councillor Moran is a seconder. Can we seek leave to vary, members? All those in favour?
Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Thank you, members. I have one question through to administration. It's in the subtext of the report. It talks to the chamber and the ability or the lack of ability to implement technology into the chamber, Chair. I would just seek assurances from the CEO that there is no move whatsoever for council meetings not to be held in the council chamber. They've been held in that room for 150 years, Chair. And I don't believe it would be appropriate at all for us to even vaguely contemplate
so the whole
council meetings anywhere else.
Question, Lord Mayor.
Yeah, through the Chair, there's been no consideration of relocating the council meeting proper at all. In fact, we're looking at the moment at some technology that can improve our decision making within the council chamber.
So just on that.
Thank you, Chair.
So the technology aspects, the Lord Mayor question, so that's covered.
Through the Chair, we actually have next week for the council meeting an initial trial of some technology to actually put that into the chamber. I think some of the key issues we've observed is the lack of the ability to see the motions and members to actually have those visually so they can read them through the meeting. So we're doing a bit of a pilot next week, which will be the test in there to see with some small devices that don't interfere with line of sight and aren't too overbearing given the chamber and its heritage and the amenity of it, and we'll actually seek your feedback in relation to that as an initial step. And we are also looking further at, and we'll come back to council in relation to how we would stream and the options that are available within the chamber should council seek after this pilot within the committee room to actually stream the council meetings as well.
Lord Mayor, questions answered?
Okay, questions answered. Thank you very much, members. I'm very comfortable with this now that the committee has accepted those variations. Thank you, Councillor Maloney.
Thank you, sir. Deputy Lord Mayor, sorry, and then Councillor Corbell. Apologies, Deputy, for missing you.
No, that's okay. The Lord Mayor's made the amendments. I was going to make
some. Excellent. No, Councillor Corbell, do you have any? You're speaking against or for? We're running out of time.
I'm speaking for.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah. We're... And actually, unlike some other members, I don't always take my full 5 minutes, so I'm going to take maybe 1 minute to speak. I think that this is good because I was actually supportive of the 3 minutes. If I consider we've been on council for 2 years, if we had tallied up the total amount of time that each of us had spoken at meetings at council and at committees.
Look at me, councillor. No, you don't have to look at councillor.
Yeah,
then speak to the chair. It would be interesting to see that graph. It was
keep drawing it.
I have drawn it. Not to be condescending. I'm down at the lower end and others are up. I am favourable. I think if you want to say something generally, you can debate it in 3 minutes. You should be able to get your point across. And then there was factored in the opportunity for the chair to be able to provide that extra time, which might exceed 5 minutes. So I was quite okay with that. I think it's good for us to have reduced meetings, and also with the agenda, I think it's important for us as an elected body to be looking at high level important, significant matters, policy, strategy, budget, these sorts of things. I've found that in the last 2 years, it could be that we come to committee and we spend an hour debating about a peppercorn tree or Margaret Street or longer, And then we do again in the council chamber the following week. And then it comes back because it's deferred and we do it again. And it just zaps us of our time. And then on that agenda, there could be other really significant, important things for discussion which are put at the end. And we just brush them through because we spent an hour discussing something which is reasonably insignificant. I hope that this will address it. I think that that will be a key improvement for us to be able to focus more on high-level issues and matters. And I think also for the workshop, it will be good to hear more from the administration informally, to hear what their perspective is and to maybe enter into the debate, whereas now that's discouraged. We discourage that. And then they can take on board our ideas and thoughts and put that into the recommendations that we take to council. So overall, I think I'm very supportive of this. I think it's going to be a good thing. I found this whole idea of the committees and then to the council is it's confusing for the public, and it's confusing trying to explain it to people that want to come in and do deputations and public forums. It's hard for them to understand the process. This is much more simple.
2 minutes and 40 seconds. So, Councillor Moran.
Yes, I will be brief. I mean, I 21 years I've seen a lot of changes. When I first came, you had a council meeting and then the committee, you had dinner and then the committee straight afterwards, which was exhausting, but it was a good system. And in between that, with the change of council, I've seen many different ones. Now, there's always a resistance, I think, to you get comfortable. This is not how we've always done it at all. And I've seen many changes. So I'm happy with, I'm not a bit reluctant, but I've seen in this council some counterproductive changes in the way councillors behave. And I've also seen the lamented that the council meeting itself has been diminished by the, in the old days, you couldn't move en bloc, you had to move every motion, and that elicited some debate. The Lord Mayor, I'm just going to adopt as the Lord Mayor speaking, God, why? But then with this new system, as you said, you have to. But if we had the committee meetings, I would advise you politically, never you are the Lord Mayor over the top, but I can see with this system that you really don't have any voice. 3 minutes I was happy with. I don't think I've ever been so grindingly frustrated in my 21 years of people over debating. If you can't crystallise your thoughts in 3 minutes, you're not going to be listened to for the last two, and I'm sick of it. So I'm obviously the Lord Mayor wants 5 minutes, but really, you know, you are driving people away from the council. If you have to not do that, speak succinctly and speak quickly. The media will be just as interested, Sandy. They'll get our agendas for the workshops. I totally agree with you. I can't understand why that phrase was put in there that this would discourage media. The media is our voice to the public. We don't have a very good voice, but that they are, and it burns us sometimes, but I don't mind that at all. 5 minutes at a quorum, I was happy to support the five. I mean, I consider these a bit like the informal gatherings that the CEO's been calling, and it's really just me, Phil, Sue, and then Priscilla, so I don't want to have to come to these and go home because we haven't got seven people. And I can see that happening with this because there's a suggestion that we just turn up, we're interested and we don't. So clearly the core people that turn up to these, which is probably a facet of them not work, not having full-time jobs. I mean, Sandy does turn up, so I shouldn't. Everybody turns up at some stage. But often, three or four people. Now, in this case, now we have to all go home because we haven't got seven. So I was happy to get five. But the rest, I think it's a suck it and see. I like the rotation of the chairs. It's a paid position, so it should be shared around, give everybody a chance. But generally, I think I've seen many changes. It all works out the same. If the councillors themselves can act in a professional, succinct manner, then any system will work. No system can fix the people on council if they don't want to be fixed. So I think we just try this one. We just as good. The one thing I said to the CEO is I want weekly meetings. I don't want us to lose track of the council, and this still provides those, so I'm happy.
Any other debate?
3 3/4 minutes.
Excellent, members. Be it that there's none, before Councillor Marnie sums up, I just want to say a couple of comments. Look, I'm very supportive of this, probably of the same mindset of some of the councillors around the three-minute discussion. I think some didn't quite have a look, but there is the ability of leaving the meeting to speak for longer. The whole discussion around this specific notion of changes of governance is around giving more delegated authority to administration through controlled budgets process for us to think a bit more strategically, for us to discuss more at the committee, at the council meeting, but also workshops become non-compulsory, so they become issue-based, Lord Mayor. So I'm also very concerned around the 7 to 5, because it may detract from some councillors that have a lot of interest in a specific topic to come to a workshop, where some others might be either equipped with the information or they've seeked the information in alternate methods and they're prepared to come to the council meeting to debate the issue. So I have a concern with moving back to 5, because back to 7, just in case we can't get that, then there'll be council members that are after the information that are in this room that potentially can't have that time at a workshop with administration because simply other council members can't attend. So the purpose of the workshop is a non-compulsory based membership for information and discussion, and obviously what happens in the chamber happens in the chamber. But look, nevertheless, I think it's a move in the right direction, and I do think that with an open mind over the next few months, we will be able to make adjustments, changes. There'll be some uncomfortable things we need to manage, but I just want you to sort of have an open mind with this and give it a go. And I'm sure accordingly we'll perfect it. It'll be a new thing for admin as well in managing agendas, but I'm certain we will get to a good place with it all. So look, I'm quite supportive of this, and I would ask Councillor Maloney to sum up.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, look, this is a trial, so if the quorum doesn't work, we can in 6 months review it. 5 minutes doesn't work, we can 6 months review it. I was just going to pick up on a few, debunk a few myths. Everyone on this council is here because they care. And this change doesn't detract from that whatsoever. This is around about empowering council, having good, robust debate in an open forum, and giving the Lord Mayor some opportunity as well. I think it doesn't have anything to do with the media. The media are going to sit in the same position that they were in the gallery here in committee meetings and make their own judgments as they normally would, as with the council agendas, and the committee agendas will be equally available for discussion. So this is around, I think this is a good opportunity for us to give this a go. I'm excited to trial that new technology in the chamber. I think that will be very useful. But let's just remove all the conspiracy theories of this. This is an opportunity for us to try. We're all in the room, we're all here for the same reason, to do good for Adelaide. So let's just continue to focus on that.
Thank you, Councillor. With that, I put that to you. All those in favour? All those against, that is carried. Yep, that is the actual recommendation, so we don't have a substantive. So I'll move to the next item. Deputy Lord Mayor, you've pulled item 11. Are you moving a motion?
I've got one question that I'm probably happy to move as quickly.
So are you happy to move first, or do you want to ask a question first? I might just get someone else to move that. Can I have a mover? Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Martin. Are you happy to reserve your right, Lord Mayor?
I reserve my right, Chair.
Councillor Martin.
Ditto.
Deputy Lord Mayor.
So, firstly, can I thank the administration for the work they've done on it. I think it's a good methodology. But I'm just wondering, is it going to cover, it's an issue that Councillor Martin mentioned last week. I sort of hesitate to use the word punitive rates, but rates that can be applied, for example, to premises that are left uncut. Right. Is that going to be part of the scope?
Through the chair, yes. All options which will be workshopped with you as well through the core committee structure, should that be endorsed next week, will be workshopped with members, including those types of concerns and any ability or non-ability to raise rates under the relevant acts will be canvassed.
Thank you.
Deputy Lord Mayor.
Excellent, thank you. And I'm very, very happy to support it. Thank you.
Thank you. So this has been moved and seconded by the Lord Mayor and Councillor Martin. Any debate or discussion, members, in relation to this item? You're speaking against it, Councillor?
Please ask a question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
What consideration is there or could there be through this of looking at rates based on development potential? So if someone has left a site derelict, but if the site has got enormous development potential, take a Laconia site, something like that, the rates just reflect the development potential.
Through the chair, that's why we've engaged an expert in this field to answer exactly those types of questions. Yeah. From my own knowledge of the Local Government Act, that would some other methodologies of valuation, such as land value or capital value, may well be achieve that aim more effectively. But exactly how that looks and how the best way to respond to that particular question will be part of this report as well and part of the discussion with members.
Thank you, Mark. Because I think one of the scourges of Adelaide is the practice of land banking and escalating approvals for the sake of escalating land value whilst not actually land.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord Mayor Stark.
Honourable Chair, members, I commend this to you. John Comrie, in my experience, is the kind of preeminent expert in this area when it comes to local government rating mechanisms. So I think that Mark is working with absolutely the right third party on this matter. So I commend this to you.
Excellent. I'll put that. All those in favour, members. All those against, that item is carried. Move on to other items. Is there any other business? There is no other business.
Only to say thank you, Chair, for your work today.
No, you're very welcome. It's very lovely of you. Item.
Given that your position will no longer exist after tonight.
That's all right. It's
for and the... I'm just clarifying why I've said it.
Well, it's for the betterment of the city, so it's a good decision.
Or motivated, there wasn't an ulterior motive.
So there is no other business, members, so I'd seek someone to move an exclusion of item 14, moved by Councillor Curran, seconded by Councillor Malani. Members, I need to note that we need to move two exclusions. The first one's item 15, the award of contract for construction of works to deliver the Hindley Street West Stage 2, which has been moved and seconded. Can I put that to you? All those in favour? All those against, that is carried. Another exclusion is relating to an urgent emerging risk item that the CEO brought to my attention. I also need someone to move an exclusion for that, moved by the Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Malani. Any debate or discussion? I put that. All those in favour, all those against, that is carried. I think we've already moved on, but if I could have the camera switched off and any members of staff or public that are not directly connected to this item, take them to the room and close the door, which